Because we're like 2 weeks behind. Typically for 6 weeks, the church for 1500 years, actually more than that, the church has taken the 6 weeks before Easter to prepare for Easter. And that doesn't mean we hide Easter eggs 6 weeks early and let kids use their noses to find them in the field. Come Easter morning, doesn't mean we start decorating the church early, and it certainly doesn't mean we just practice the Easter specials and see if we can still hit those low notes in Via Dolorosa, and the high notes in Christ Alone. I can't hit either, so I can't hit any note if you ask my wife. But that's not what we do for 6 weeks. Instead, for 6 weeks, we just prepare our hearts, and we prepare our minds, and we prepare our body, our church body, our congregation, to hear the good news on Easter morning again, that Christ has conquered death. That when God reached down and grabbed Jesus out of death, all of those of us who are attached by faith to Jesus came out of death with him on that glorious day. And so we take 6 weeks to remind ourselves that we are a very broken people in need of a great mechanic. And we're a very broken people in need of a great physician. And the world is a very hurting place in need of the comfort and guidance that only God can give through the resurrection. And so in that spirit, we have some catching up to do. I'm not going to make excuses, but I did just move across a couple states, On Ash Wednesday, which kicks off this six-week preparation, we were unloading my moving truck, and many of you probably already heard me say, ashes to ashes, dust to dust, pretty much sums up all your stuff packed into one little moving truck, But we're racing now. We're getting going, and we're headed towards Easter. And it's fitting that we're racing because The book of the Bible that the church has chosen this year to lead us to Easter is the Gospel of Mark. It's the second book in your New Testament, one of four sort of extended stories about Jesus. And what makes Mark different is that Mark overuses this word immediately. It's like Jesus is in this big hurry in the Gospel of Mark. Jesus is immediately doing everything. I mean, Jesus doesn't just heal people, he immediately heals them. And he doesn't just turn around and speak, he immediately whips around and speaks. He's just always running, he's racing. And he talks kind of fast in Mark's Gospel, kind of like I talk fast, so I can relate. So we have some catching up to do, and as we get going, I have a little clicker here. We're trying out the clicker. I also have Debbie, who's a good clicker too. And so, bummer. Go ahead, Debbie. So it's fitting that we begin with sort of a few notes about the Gospel of Mark and the other Gospels. It's been said that if the Gospels were brothers, John would be the oldest. Those of you who are the oldest or have oldest children, or who are younger siblings can all relate to this. Do we have any oldest children in the room? Raise your hand if you're an old, or point at your older brother. As what's going on over here. And so John is, you know how oldest children are. They're bold, they're courageous, they're driven, they're headstrong, and the Gospel of John is all those things. And in the Gospel of John, Jesus isn't just the Son of Man, he's the way, the truth, and the life, John just brings out all his guns, and he's just this bold, courageous gospel. And nowhere is this more evident than in the opening chapter, where John tells us about the incarnation of Jesus with a pretty poem, because John just has to write poetry for you. And so we have this gorgeous prologue that the metaphors just sort of drip over each other. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. That's where we get that word incarnation, by the way. And then it's been said that if the four Gospels were four brothers, Matthew and Luke would be the twins. Does anybody have a family? Is anybody a twin, first of all? Anybody? You are? anybody know twins? You guys know twins. I love twins. They are so entertaining. Because here's the thing with twins is, you could go to the next slide, Debbie. They grow up together, and so they look alike and act alike and kind of talk alike, and yet they've spent time learning how to differentiate themselves from each other in very entertaining ways. And so when you get twins in a room, they just sort of play off of each other, and their personalities are just a little bit different. And that's the way it is with Matthew and Luke in their Gospels. They both tell the same stories, but they tell them in entirely different ways and bring different things into that. And so they kind of play off of each other. And in their opening chapters, instead of a poem like that driven older brother John, they tell a story, and it's fun to read those stories together. We do that every December at Christmas time. We talk about, Luke brings the shepherds, and Matthew brings the wise men, and we read those stories, and we populate the nativity. And in Luke, the angel goes to Mary, and in Matthew, the angel goes to Joseph. And so it's really fun just to read these two together, and it's entertaining to read them together. Then it's been said, if the four Gospels were four brothers, poor Mark would be that youngest child. Do we have any youngest children in the room? You know, we have a few. You guys know what I'm talking about. I have a younger sister. I'm quite fond of her still. We were best friends growing up. But I know about younger siblings. I know all about them. The younger siblings are wonderful. They are absolutely amazing people. Hear me say that. And yet they're just different from their siblings. Especially the more children you have, it seems the more different the last one is. They're the lovers of the family, which is a great thing. And the younger siblings, sort of at least when they're growing up, their sort of journey is, the common journey that most young siblings share, is they want to be like their oldest siblings, but they're not. And so it is with Mark's gospel. Mark wants to be like Matthew and Luke. He tells the same stories, and yet he's just not Matthew and Luke. And for that reason, for about 1900 years, nobody even really bothered with Mark. You'll find passing references to the gospel of Mark, but it wasn't until 1950 that scholars started studying Mark and studying Mark seriously, because we realized that Mark knows what he's doing. He's a perfectly wonderful sibling. And so in Mark, the incarnation, the story about Jesus, is really just told with one word, and it's this word, torn. We're not given the story of Jesus' birth. We're not given a pretty poem. What we're given is Jesus appears by the River Jordan and asks John the Baptist to baptize him. There's a little bit of a discussion that happens. John baptizes him, and when Jesus is baptized, we're told the heavens were torn open. Now, I gave Desiree a piece of paper. Desiree, stand up. Hope you're okay with that. Tear it in half for us. Tear it in half. There you go. Now, you guys didn't see her face. You can sit down. Keep it, though. We'll go back to that. You didn't see her face, but when you open something, it's easy. In Matthew and Luke, the heavens were opened, that God sort of opened a door. And anybody can open a door. You know, my daughter learned to open doors when she was like a year and a half, and nothing was safe again. But doors are easy to open. Now, tear requires some muscle. It requires some concentration. And I can relate to this because I'm a cross-country runner. Go ahead, Debbie. And in cross-country, we're kind of the youngest siblings of sports, and that we never get to do this. You go to a cross-country race, they just line you up on a line, they shoot a gun, and you go. You know, there's no power, there's no symbolism, there's nothing. And they used to put a string across the finish line, so at least if you won the race, you got to kind of run through a string, which is kind of pathetic, but at least it's something. And I won my first race, and there wasn't a string. They had done away with that. They don't do that anymore. They use cameras and all this technology stuff that's a lot of fun if you're, like, you know, using it, but not a lot of fun when you don't get to, you know, break a string at the finish line. And so I had my pose all figured out, and it wasn't there. And so, but football, like, that's a different story. There's this whole hour-long ceremony that happens before they punt that ball. They introduce the coaches. They thank the sponsors. Any distinguished guests, they say stuff to. They do the Pledge of Allegiance, then they do the National Anthem, then they do God Bless America just to be safe, you know? And then the home team comes ripping out, and they rip out through a vinyl banner, and the symbolism is one of power. It's one that we're going to dominate this banner, like we're going to dominate that other team, right? We're here to dominate for the sake of domination, and it's this wonderful image of power. And so when Jesus is baptized, God rips the heavens open as this wonderful image of power that now I'm here. But there's something else that's kind of going on here. Their thinking about science they didn't know as much as we did. And it was thought that there was us sort of down here, and then there was this blanket, or this steel sort of blanket that covers the sky, and then there's God. And of course, there's all sorts of trapdoors in the blanket, because that's how angels get in and out. But if you wanted to get to heaven, you had to find what Jacob found, which is a ladder leading up to one of the trapdoors. And so God knows where these trapdoors are, and God can open them whenever God wants. But ultimately, God holds the keys. And if you ever did something foolish, like, say, try to build a tower up there, God's going to come down and mix up all the languages and scatter y'all, you know? So we know not to do that. And so the thinking was, you have these trapdoors everywhere, and only God knows where they are. And so when Mark says the heavens are torn open at Jesus' baptism, I think I have a slide for this, Debbie. The heavens are torn open. The image is not of what sort of Matthew and Luke give us, you know, trap door opens and then the spirit floats down like a feather, like a dove. Instead, it's more like this. More like this symbol of power that God has ripped open the heavens, and now that dove is plummeting down and God is thundering down with power to say, I'm here. And the meaning of the tear is power, but there's also this sense of permanence to it. There's this idea that what God has done is say, I'm here and I'm here to stay. So Desiree, can you close that piece of cardboard? Can you put it back together? Now let go of it. So that's the image. You can close an open door. But when God tears open the heavens, the image is of God saying, I just did something permanent here. That these heavens are permanently torn open, that there's no closing them, there's no hemming them back together, that I've thundered through them, and I am permanently among you, that I am here to stay. My presence is permanently here in the Holy Spirit. And that's the imagery. So with that said, I'm not so sure. Go ahead, Debbie. I'm not so sure and that's an image. That's the best one I could find of the Spirit coming down. Go ahead. So I'm not so sure that does the trick. Instead, I kind of like this one, and we'll see if it actually plays. There we go. I kind of like that. Many of you might know what movie that's from. That's from one of the James Bond movies. I was trying to find Terminator, but I couldn't find the clip. But it's the tearing through the wall to save. Most of you, if those of you know the movie, know he's trying to save a bomb maker from blowing up stuff there, some James Bond plot like that. But it's the idea that God is not saying, I'm here to dominate for the sake of domination. I'm not just here to say, ha-ha, look, I can rip the heavens open, see how powerful I am. God is saying, I'm here to save you. I'm here to be your Lord and Savior. I'm tearing through the walls of the heavens, of the skies, for the purposes of dominating sin and death for the sake of your salvation. So that's the image. Many people have also noted that there's another tear in Mark. It's the same word and it doesn't appear till the end. Go ahead. It's the, one more. It's the scene that's crucial to our faith. It's the scene that we celebrate and commemorate around this time every year. Jesus has been arrested. He's been betrayed by his friend. He's been put on trial two or three times. They did justice more swiftly than we do, and he's been found guilty. So they drag him up. Actually, they make him drag his own cross up to Golgotha, and there they crucify him between two criminals. And read with me here. This is what Mark tells us about this. Mark says, at noon, this is chapter 15, verse 33, at noon darkness came over the land until 3. And at 3, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani, which means, my God, why have you forsaken me? When some of those standing nearby heard this, they said, listen, he's calling Elijah. So someone ran, they filled a sponge with wine vinegar, they put it on a staff, and they offered it to Jesus to drink. Now leave him alone, they said, and let's actually see if Elijah comes to take him down. But with a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Moving from the very scientific sky, go ahead, Debbie. Moving from the very scientific sky to a very religious temple, their thinking once again was a little bit different than ours, and that they thought one of those spots, one of those trap doors by which God gets to us and we get to God, is the Holy of Holies. And so the Holy of Holies is just a way of saying there's many holy places out there, but this is the holiest. This is where God is most present to us. And so they built a curtain there to kind of protect us from God and kind of protect God from us. And it was thought that only the most chosen and the most pure and the most forgiven could go back behind that curtain. And so they did all these preparations. You had to be chosen by God, but you also had to be chosen by the people. And then they did all the sacrifices to make sure all your sins had been forgiven. And then they gave you just a ton of baths to scrub away all the dirt and earwax and all that stuff. And then after all that, they still tied a rope around you in case, you know, they missed some earwax and God struck you dead. You know, because if God's striking people dead, we're not going to go get the body, you know, so we'll just pull the rope out, you know, was the thinking. And so this curtain separates us. It actually protects us from God is sort of the thinking. That God's glory is so much bigger and more magnificent than ours. To go back there without being chosen and forgiven and purified would be to die, to be dead. And so here we have this wonderful scene at the end of Jesus' life where once again God tears something open to show us that I'm permanently on the loose, that I'm out here now, that my presence is fully available to anybody who wants it, that this powerful, almighty God whose glory is so overwhelming has now just been scattered to all corners of the globe and to all peoples is what we find out. So here you have these two tears, one at the beginning at Jesus' baptism, and one right there at the end. Go ahead, Debbie. You can kind of see where the holy oak there is. And one at the beginning and one at the end, and both of them show us God has permanently shown up. That these barriers that wall us off from God are now gone, so that we can come to God and God can come to us. Guys, this is really, really good news. But it's also really, really bad news. And so we're going to start with the good news because, you know, I'm an optimistic person. I like starting with the bad news. The good news is I think about the celebrities that I would like to meet. I listed them up there for you. Just don't judge me. If you can read that, you know, there's some celebrities I'd like to meet. Two of them have passed away now, which is kind of sad. There's, you know, I did, you know, there's sports heroes on there. There's politicians, there's movie actors, and then there's writers. So I've covered the bases, and that's just half the list. And I think about this list of people that I wouldn't mind liking to meet. And the reality is that for most of them, not all of them, but maybe most of them, if I were to just go say hi to them, it might not end well for me. If I were just to sort of go into their living room, it probably wouldn't go well after that, if they were just to come home one day. And in fact, with, you know, with a current or former or future president, if I were just to crash the Oval Office one day, it would not go well for me. Someone made it into a hallway of the West Wing a few months ago, and it did not end well for him. He is staring at a jail cell the rest of his life. So there's all these barriers to wall me off from these celebrities. And some of them are very actual barriers. They're like big curly security guards with like tasers, you know. Some of them are more cultural and metaphorical, just, you know, rules of politeness and rules of etiquette that sort of keep us safe and keep us civilized. Well, the reality is that because God has ripped open the heavens and torn open the curtain, we now can crash the throne room of heaven. We can now enter into the throne room of all creation and have a conversation. In fact, do life with, be friends with the Holy One. The author of Hebrews puts this brilliantly. He says, therefore, since we have this high priest Jesus who has permanently connected us to God, let us therefore come boldly unto the throne of grace. Boldly doesn't mean arrogantly or proudly. It just means boldly. It just means you can enter in knowing that you belong here. That you're not going to get thrown out. No security guard's going to tackle you and taser you. And the rules of etiquette absolutely demand you go boldly. There aren't those rules that sanction us off from them, from God anymore. That's the good news. But it's Lent. So we got to talk about the bad news too. Going back to that list of celebrities, the reality is, as much as I would love to meet these people and love to have a conversation with them and ask them my questions, I have my list of questions for each one I want to ask. If I didn't get to choose the time and place we met and have time to prepare for that, it would be a very awkward conversation for me. The more spiritually religious on this list, and I didn't put the general superintendents of the Church of Nazarene there, but the reality was, if I were to walk in this morning and one of the general superintendents of our church was waiting there, I would be preaching a very, very different sermon this morning. Yeah, you know, everything would change. And I'd probably be like, I've only been here a week. I've only been here a week. I've only been here a week. You know, and I would be saying, if I were to go home and one of these people were just to be sitting in my living room waiting for me, there'd be some dusting I would want to do before they showed up. There'd be some cleaning. There'd be some things I might just need to get rid of. Some TV shows, video games, I don't know what else. In fact, if any of these were just on the loose, just dropping into church to meet me or dropping into my living room, there'd be some things I would need to fix about myself, some things I'd need to get straight. And so if the great creator of all the universe, the famous one, has crashed through that temple curtain that protected us from God as much as it protected God from us, God's crashed through that curtain, there's some things we should probably get rid of. There's some bad attitudes, there's some bad habits, there's some bad actions. That as much as God is love and God loves us, there's still some attitudes and actions just God doesn't tolerate, that love doesn't tolerate. There's some hatred, some frustrations, some bitterness that I'd have to just throw out. There'd be some dusting and cleaning to do. So I guess I'd say if God has shredded the heavens to be with us, there's some stuff that we should probably shred too. Yeah, that's what my living room tends to look like with two kids. So I want to close today just asking you, what needs shredded? What do you need to shred? If this almighty presence has come into your life, is there something, is there an attitude, an action that you might want to get rid of? I'm going to ask the worship team to come back up. And I found a shredder this week. I was kind of looking around the church, and I found a shredder. I'm going to put it up here. And there's pieces of paper right here. You don't have to bring your own pencil or pen. That should be, if you need to borrow one, you can. And it's set to auto, so as we sing, if there's something that God's calling you to get rid of this morning, just to leave right here, This God who has shredded open the heavens and shredded open that curtain to be fully present to us, if there's something you need to shred in order to be fully present to God, then I'd welcome you just write it down on this piece of paper, one of these pieces of paper, and then just run it through the shredder. Just run it through. And as you do, I know it's just a simple act, a simple sign, but as you do, I just pray that you experience the overwhelming grace and forgiveness of God as you do. If you need to stick around after that and pray, I'll be here. Debbie's in the back, but we can certainly, she can come up and pray for you. And then there's others too who might want to fill in. But as we sing this song, as we re-sing the last song we sang, there's something God's calling you to maybe get rid of and maybe start working on so that you can be fully present. I just invite you, come write it down and run it through the shredder. If the kids want to do it, I just ask a parent, help them so they don't shred any fingers. That's not something God wants us to get rid of. And so, let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for shredding the heavens to be with us. Now I pray you give us the boldness to shred the things in our life that are displeasing to you. In your name, amen. If anybody feels so led and wants to share what they shredded, I'd certainly want to give you the time to do that. No pressure, obviously, if you don't want to, but if anybody wants to share and just say, hey, here's what I gave to God today. That's nodding. I wrote down impatience. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, once again, we just come to you in gratitude that you are fully present to us. You have broken through the barriers, some of the barriers that others have put up, some of the barriers we ourselves have put up. And we praise you that you are love, that you are always breaking through to us. And now I just pray that you also give us the strength. Mm-hmm. Give us the strength to leave our guilt and our impatience and our frustrations and our bad habits and our bad attitudes. Just give us the strength to leave those here so that we continue to do life with you out there, so that others can see the freedom from this stuff that we have and ask us for the hope that we have. May you continue to be present to each and every one of us as we go back out into the world to serve you in our various capacities and to represent you as light to this dark world. And may you draw us ever closer to your cross in your name. Amen. You'll stand with me and receive this benediction. Now may the one who has torn through into your life purify and sanctify you through and through, and be ever present to you this week as you seek to walk in the steps of the Almighty God. Go in peace. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Hearts unfold like clouds before you. Joyful, joyful, we adore you. Joyful, we adore you. Sure.